What a wonderful surprise! We have to say we cannot really believe it, but NASA actually picked SpaceX for the human landing system of the Artemis program. Let's talk about this wonderfully unexpected event real quick. So, as a refresher, the Artemis program is NASA's new initiative to bring back people to the moon. The sister program of Apollo, if you will, which is of course also reflected in the name since Artemis really is the sister of Apollo in Greek mythology. This program goes back in development to 2017, but was officially announced on May 14, 2019 by good old Jim Bridenstine, with the goal of returning humans to the moon by 2028. Then on March 26, 2019, then Vice President Mike Pence announced that the landing date would be 2024 instead of 2028, a surprise to many. The 2024 goal was really ambitious and it would have needed significant budget increases in NASA's human spaceflight branch to even stand a chance of making it happen. Only 2 months ago, Acting Administrator Steve Jurczyk reiterated these budget concerns and said that the 2024 goal may not longer be a realistic target. We assumed that 2026 might be a more realistic target, although even as late as 2028 seems possible. The Artemis is in many regards quite similar to the Apollo program. In Apollo we had the Saturn V, now there is SLS. Instead of the Apollo capsule, we now have Orion. The Gateway, a space station to orbit the moon, will be new here, which had no counterpart during the Apollo missions. However, it is at this point not really clear if the first Artemis moon landings will make use of the Gateway. Now that the landing date is 2026 or later, it might very well be the case that the moon lander will be docked to the Gateway before landing on the moon. In the Apollo program, the lander which actually landed astronauts on the moon was called the Lunar Module, sometimes also Lunar Excursion Module. The counterpart in the Artemis program is the Human Landing System. This is what actually lands people on the moon. And until yesterday, there were 3 competitors in the race to build the moon lander in this new moon landing effort. We had Dynetics, a Leidos company, with their Alpaca lander. This lander had some key advantages and was together with the Moon Starship, about which we'll talk soon, our favorite lander. It was designed to be spacious, also modular, so you can transform it, for example, into a pressurized rover or use the landing platform to land cargo payloads. Also, it had big solar arrays and was really low-lying to the lunar surface so that the astronauts would have been able to enter and exit really easily. It was a 2-stage lander which would have shed the fuel tanks during descent to the surface. The estimated total development cost for this lander would have been around $5.2 billion. The next lander we often like to call the Lobby Lander by the national team. Why? Well, because it's twice as expensive as the Dynetics Alpaca with an estimated development cost of a bit over $10 billion. Why was it so expensive? Well, because 4 companies would have been involved in its development, namely Blue Origin, Draper, Northrop and Lockheed. Especially the latter 2 are used to fat paychecks from the government. Their lander would have consisted of 3 elements: a descent stage, a transfer stage and an ascent stage. So it was by far the most complicated and also the most expensive design. So this, in combination with the old space companies that don't really value cost efficiency, made it our least favorite lander. And then there's of course the Lunar Starship. The Lunar Starship came as a big surprise to many, because it doesn't fit any moon lander category that had been established before. It is much larger than the other 2 landers, sports a much higher landing capacity both in terms of payload weight and in terms of interior volume. While the other 2 landers can land maybe a few metric tons of cargo on the lunar surface and sport maybe a few dozen cubic meters of interior volume, the Lunar Starship comes in with a whopping 1,000 cubic meters of interior volume and a landing capacity of, in theory, 100 metric tons to the lunar surface. So okay, Surely this behemoth must then be more expensive than the other two contenders, right? Nope. It is actually about half of the alpaca and a quarter of what the Lobbylander would have cost. But we still thought that it was extremely unlikely that NASA would decide for SpaceX. Why? Because this moon landing approach is new, radical, untested. And during the last decades, NASA showed us that they are really very cautious when it comes to such things. Also, there's the lobbying aspect. The old space companies such as Boeing, Lockheed, and Northrop are known to employ lobbying more often than not. We were absolutely sure that this would certainly have a big influence on the decision making at NASA, since a lot of lobbying was also involved in deciding to use the overpriced and outdated SLS and Orion architecture. This architecture is basically super expensive, an SLS rocket costing easily $1 billion per launch, and it is not even reusable. The companies involved in SLS and Orion are of course Lockheed and Boeing. So we assumed that the most likely outcome of the human landing competition would of course be the national team as winner. Our most likely outcome for this was Lobbylander first place, Alpaca second place, and nothing for SpaceX. In a more optimistic vision, we thought that maybe Alpaca would be first place and the Lobbylander second. In an even more optimistic scenario, we thought that Alpaca would be first place and SpaceX would be second place. But no! Yesterday, NASA officially announced that it would move forward only with SpaceX. This is really unexpected and a very positive surprise. Very, very positive. It shows that logic and rationality are apparently still more powerful than lobbying. This makes us really hopeful for the future of NASA and the future of human spaceflight in general. If rationality can win over lobbying, then maybe there is really still hope for government agencies like NASA to continue playing a role in human spaceflight. So now that this has happened, what does that mean for the future of Artemis? Well, first of all, it means that SpaceX will now get a nice $2.8 billion from NASA for development of the Moon Starship. Second of all, it means that our perfect ideal scenario will unfold, namely that the US will return to the Moon while SpaceX will be already preparing to send astronauts to Mars, both at the same time. This is the perfect scenario and it couldn't have gone better. We basically will be getting the Moon and Mars. We won't have to decide anymore between the two. Also, the lunar starship being so large and capable will allow NASA to build a moon base far quicker than would have been possible with the other landers. We shouldn't forget that China and Russia are teaming up to build a moon base starting from around 2030. It would be highly unwise to leave the lunar playground to them. And for all intents and purposes, one starship in itself is already a freaking moon base. I mean, just look at this behemoth. This is the new rendering, by the way, that has been released just yesterday. We can already see some changes to the previous lunar starship iteration. For one, the landing legs now look much more realistic. They are further apart and have far larger supporting surfaces than the previous ones. This is much more realistic for providing stable support on the lunar regolith. Also, the solar panels cover a larger surface area now. Here we can see the crane in action where the astronauts will be lowered to the lunar surface. It will be really interesting to see the fail-safe mechanism of this crane in case of a malfunction. We are certain the engineers at NASA and SpaceX will come up with something intelligent. Also, it was mentioned that the astronauts will be transported to lunar orbit with an SLS launch and in the Orion capsule, where the capsule will dock with Starship and Starship will then descend to the lunar surface. It has not been detailed how the lunar Starship will be refueled. This will also be very interesting once we get to learn the details. Will oxygen for fuel be extracted on the moon? Will the methane be shipped from Earth in tanker starships? Will they also try to refine methane from lunar regolith? Questions and questions, but we are sure to get more answers soon. Anyways, we just wanted to make a quick episode about this because we think that this is an awesome day for humanity and a big cause for celebration. NASA has positively surprised us, and this bodes really well for the future of human spaceflight. Zhixuan is, by the way, taking a break from YouTube, so you will have to make do with me now for a while. So then, let us be happy about these wonderful events and on to the future.